There exists a principle that has been long established, which the Aristotelians may not be able to overpower. This is the principle of the good that is anchored in the nature of humanity, no matter how small-minded it may become. The German poet Johann Wolfgang von Goethe wrote a dramatic play on the scene with the title Faust. In the play, the devil beguiles a student. He promises to fulfill all his desires in exchange for his soul that the student finds no value in anyway. Thus a pact is forged. But surprisingly, the student finds himself exonerated at the end of his life by the heavens' intervention after he had done a work of great good for society. With the exoneration, the contract with the devil is broken. It is announced in the play that a good man, in spite of his dark yearnings and inclinations, is nevertheless aware of what the right path is. This applies to congressmen and senators and society alike. In the dramatic play Faust, the good wins out. But will it win out in 2020? Who holds the key in our time for this hope to come true? Who makes the effort to stop the failures of democracy that cater to mediocrity, to low-level consensus, that fosters small-minded thinking, as Socrates had recognized already more than 2,400 years ago? Is it the president's task alone to raise up the democratic environment to the apprehension of the principles of the republic, as Lincoln had done to secure the emancipation with the 13th Amendment of the Constitution? Or is this task the task of society itself? Did anyone stand up in Athens in the year 399 BC and uplift the system of democracy at that time to such heights that Athens' foremost philosopher, Socrates, would not be murdered by the state? It appears that ultimately it is the task of society to assure that its agencies of government measure up to the highest principles known. If this means uplifting democracy out of the sewer of its failures, it must be done, or else society itself is doomed by its failing to accomplish that. Civilization is evidently not something that is guaranteed. It must be built and be defended actively. These actions are imperative. Indeed, they are more imperative in the present, where the nuclear war challenge and the Ice Age challenge are standing ominously on the near horizon. The principle of the future becomes apparent in this case, because it can no longer be taken for granted that humanity will have a future. To assure the future of humanity becomes thereby the task of the present. This means that the monster traps must be shut down one way or another. The time has come for humanity to raise itself up as a people and to discover the potentials within it and its power for good. This is imperative, supremely. The world is presently trapped into multiple wars against itself, which it cannot see, while it should be in a war for its future to meet its needs. Society needs to shut down the very potential for war and create itself a vast new platform for living under a sun that is diminishing towards the next ice age that cannot be prevented. While our world ship is sinking, no one seems interested in lifeboats. Not yet. Agricultural yields have already begun to diminish. The building of the new infrastructures that would enable agriculture to continue on a colder, ice-crusted planet is not even being considered. Much less are the infrastructures being constructed, though we need these in operation in less than 15 years. Is anyone standing in the hustings to break the global warming and the nuclear war monster traps? Only one man stands for election as president at the present time to get the job done for the nation. And the name of the man is again Donald Trump. The world is trapped to its doom by the dogma of man-made global warming and by its own small-minded mentality that accepts all the lies and opinions that support it. It has been conditioned to lay itself down to die for them, as in the days of Pericles. On the Titanic, the passengers were told not to worry about the lack of lifeboats because a rescue ship was said to be on the way. Look, its light is already on the horizon. But the ship never came. The light on the horizon went out. The 1,500 men who were trapped by this ruse went down with the ship. On the world ship today, society is told to worry only about global warming. But when the light goes out on the horizon, as it did for the Titanic, and the underlying betrayal becomes recognized, it will likely be far too late for humanity to start building the massive infrastructures that are needed for a society of 7 billion people to live securely on an ice-encrusted planet. The reaction needs to happen in our time. At the present, nothing is happening. On the Titanic, the trap did go down with the ship. If the global warming trap is not broken, the trap will go down with the world ship. Humanity cannot live without food, which it cannot grow on an ice-infested cold planet without technological infrastructures for it. The trapped victims, as I said before, will then tally up to 7 billion. Thus, as Socrates had already recognized 2,400 years ago, humanity is inherently doomed by the effects of its small-minded thinking and its political structures that keep it tied to the ground. In one way or another, whether by presidential executive actions or by society's own actions, the breakup of the super monster traps, which includes nuclear war, must succeed. Nothing less is acceptable. Even the breakup of the lesser monster traps must succeed. the physical infrastructures that must be built in preparation for the Earth reverting back to Ice Age glaciation in 30 years are too vast in scope for them to be created on any small-minded monetarist platform, private or public, and on democratic processes that hide the truth and cater to the smallness of low-level consensus under oligarchic dictates. Society must free itself from all these traps to have a future. In this case, the actual rescuing of society from the dying private monetarism and its derivatives and its financial derivatives gambling orgies, which President Trump has the potential to achieve and might achieve, would not be an end in itself, but be just a useful first step towards a comprehensive uplifting of the platforms of humanity. This does not mean that it wouldn't be prudent in our time, as in Lincoln's time, to abolish private monetarism and derivatives gambling with another amendment of the Constitution and enshrine the greenbacks as the nation's currency and the Glass-Steagall provisions as permanent. Such steps would be early steps out of the trap, with many more steps to follow. However, the man-made global warming super monster trap is not easily abolished. It is not a law that can be repealed. It is the product of armies of special agents in high places. Some have the task to sink science. Others are tasked to sink economics by blocking industrialization. And still others have the task to assure that humanity remains in the trap and will defend its entrapment until it is too late for it to escape. This still rolling power of the special operatives can only be vacated by society reaching for the truth, where the Aristotelians have no standing. As the steps are unfolding, of the truth coming to light, it will soon become apparent that the needed infrastructures for humanity's living on an ice age planet can only be built on a platform that is entirely free of monetarism and of squabbling, and that it is building on principles with higher level imperatives that supersede the childish games of the past and inspire a new humanist renaissance and new industrial revolutions for unimpeded living. This will be deemed then as natural. In natural economics, society issues itself currency to produce infrastructures that are of value to it. When the job is done, the debt by society to itself is thereby extinguished. Monetary debt must never be repaid. It would diminish the currency that enables the purchase of what is produced. This is a principle by which society pulls itself up on its bootstraps and becomes richer the more it produces. In such a case, why would society use money at all? Money is ultimately a trap. The use of money is one of the greatest errors ever committed. Money doesn't build anything. Only people do. Money is a diversion, an error in economy. But what about errors? Errors have no truth standing behind them. And without truth, they have no history. They can simply be let go. Christ Jesus, who had lived 400 years after Plato, seems to suggest what is critically needed and is natural through and through can indeed be done, both in the present and in the future, because the principles for the real already exist and have always existed and can be applied at any time. He is saying, in essence, to society, reach for the power of good that you already have, and take my yoke upon you, where you discover that its burden is light.